Are there four seasons in Los Angeles?
Nah, not
It's
really.
like two, one and a
Yeah,
half.
there's summer road reconstruction and summer, I think, are the three mainly.
You're not from Los Angeles, but how long have you been in Los Angeles now?
Many years, 20 maybe, I don't know.
Well, you're kind of a 20-year overnight sensation.
Yes, I am. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Still being discovered.
It's still
Still
every
got the
day as
best
well.
ahead of me. Yeah.
Is it surreal? I mean, you actually were able to make a career of yours for yourself as an actor for a very long time, and now all of a sudden, I guess starting with Miu and everyone we know, you kind of like blew up.
Oh, I guess. I mean, have I blown up?
It feels to like you. Well, I think it's.
Someone should tell me because I would live a totally different lifestyle if I knew that I had blown up. That would be a different thing. That's kind of you to say, but yeah, it has been a slow burn, yeah, for sure, for people to it happens with a lot of actors. It takes a while for people to figure out who they are, what they do.
Well, it does seem like you've known from, I know that guy too, I know that guy from, at least, no?
Yeah, that helps, I guess. My whole thing is to try to, and this really doesn't help, to be honest, is to try to remain a mystery because it's easier for people to buy you in roles when they have no clue who you are.
Yeah.
Maybe in the back of their mind they think, I've seen that guy before, but if they don't know exactly all about you and how many kids you have and what charities
Yeah.
you work for or whatever, I don't know. It's interesting.
Well, Soderbergh, who you just worked with, or
About to,
about to
actually,
work with,
yes.
he did one of these recently and did not want to be on camera for that very reason. And we shot his feet. We agreed to
Yes.
shoot his boots.
How long was the interview?
Half an hour of his
Perfect.
boots. And it was terrific. He was like, he was very, he's emotive enough that, and his feet are emotive, most
Sure.
importantly.
It's the there was the, I don't know if you remember the Replacements band. They had a music video early on in MTV that was just a Converse shoe tapping, I think, next to a speaker through the whole song.
Yes. Next time I'll have to shoot the back of his head, but
There you go.
we'll work our way all the way
It's like
through
a witness
Steven.
protection program thing or something. You maybe just alter his voice or something
That's
and
right.
squiggle his face.
Well, no, he's happy for people to know his voice, just not to see
Yeah.
his, he likes doing the commentaries.
Yeah, for a director, he's a visible guy. I
Yeah.
understand.
Well, that's he guess he shot the last one. He shot the Girlfriend Experience on the streets of New York and was, hiding with a ball cap and all that stuff and has to pretend nobody knows him.
Yeah.
Which is good. But you're now, did you get into acting thinking that everybody would know you? Was that a priority for you ever, or?
No, I've never really wanted to be the most popular. I'd rather be the most convincing, really, has always been the idea for me. Certainly when you start out and you're a kid from a little town in the Midwest and you have some kind of delusion that maybe you can make a living as an actor someday with no role model or reason to think I could. But yeah, early on, things like red carpet and interviews and photo sessions seem like exciting things.
Yeah.
No offense, but
it's I hear
it's and I, again, I don't mean to sound in the least ungrateful. You're kind to talk to me, and I hope that people want to see Winter's Moan. That's really why I'm here. But yeah, it just turns out to be less interesting than the actual acting
Yes.
part of the job for me.
Well, it's a Winter's Bone theme with us because we've shot Deborah and we've shot
Indeed.
Jennifer. Both of Deborah was actually apologizing for actually being at the Sunset Marquee. She didn't think she belonged there. And Jennifer was like, press is worse than being painted blue every day.
Oh man, look at us ungrateful
So,
assholes.
but
I
it's
don't know
it,
if I could say that on the
well, no,
computer
you
or
can
not.
say everything you want. Yes,
All
you can
right,
say any
fair.
dirty word you can come up with.
Good enough. That's all I got, really.
But it's not a natural thing to, if you really are an actor and not just a celebrity, it's not really a natural thing to go and expose yourself and be asked the same question over and over again, try to come up with a good answer each time and.
It's true, and it's it's such an interesting just the nature of celebrity or whatever in our country is an interesting topic in and of itself. But I'm certainly not at the high end of that. I can generally go have dinner and not be mobbed or have paparazzi chasing me and things like that. But it's slippery, It's how much do you want people to know about you? How much do you want to put your image out there? The great thing about it is that if people get to know you more, you may have more choices in roles, and that's, I
Right.
think, what every actor searches for. So,
Well, do you feel like you have a reputation within the directing community and, that people, that actors know you, you're an actor's actor and not necessarily
yeah,
a.
I don't know how much directors know me. I know that the casting directors have gotten to know me over the years, and that's really a great thing. They're the keys to the kingdom, as I'd read in a book many years ago, and often wonderful people. I think actors know me. I guess it's hard to say. I'm always surprised when someone who I admire, mm-hmm. you know, knows who I am or knows my work. And often bummed out when someone I admire doesn't know who I am or doesn't know my work, but that's just how it goes.
So what was the first grain of the, going back to Minnesota where you thought, acting, that's the way for me?
Yeah, I was a child star in my family, I guess, sort of. I was the youngest, and like any family, there was, you know, moments that weren't, you know, lily white and perfect, and I think that maybe as a kid a lot of what I was doing was trying to ease tension or make people laugh or mm-hmm. find a way to be joyful. I love my family, don't get me wrong, it's an amazing bunch of people, but within any family there's always going to be interesting times. So we had one channel on TV growing up, so I watched that a little bit when I wasn't running around outside, but I was interested in the stories and thought those people probably get paid, and I think I was walking around probably doing British accents as a kid for some reason because I'd seen him on TV, and never really had a real yin to be an actor. I'd been a wrestler from the time I was a little kid, and was really into that all the way to high school. And then when I wasn't so into wrestling, I quit and needed something else to do. And I guess the real germ was that in 10th grade, they piled several of us on a bus. I'd taken a drama class in high school, which was a joke class, let's be honest. It wasn't we didn't even have a theater in our high school at all. We performed in a gym, but the drama class was a way for people to get out of doing real classes. Mm-hmm. And I was a sophomore, my sister was a senior. I loved my sister. She was in the class, and I thought, well, I just want to hang out with her. That'd be great. But I loved the class. It took it kind of seriously. Mm. And we were piled onto a bus and taken to the Guthrie Theater when I was a sophomore in high school for that class, and saw The Crucible, and that was a revelation to me. That afternoon in the theater, that matinee, I sat there, and when the lights came up afterwards, just was a little changed and thought, wow, I've was made to feel something by these people telling a story. Mm. I wonder if I could, you know, make people feel something by telling a story. So it was in the back of my head, and then the next year I quit wrestling. And one of my teachers, a different teacher, had always encouraged all of his students, but had taken me aside and said, you're, you know, an interesting writer, and you're an unusual combination of shy on some days and extroverted on others. He may have been telling me in a kindly way that I was just screwed up enough to do this. I'm not sure what he was implying, but he said, this might be something you really, really like. Huh. And I had a two-line role in a play and loved it. This couldn't have been happier.
What play?
You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown. Our gymnasium was so large, and the cast is only six people. The woman who was directing, who only taught for 2 years, she was real inspired. Tamara McClintock, I still use a lot of inspiration for what she taught me in high school, in my everyday life and my work. But she was smart enough to fill out the cast, make the chorus bigger by adding characters that aren't really in the play, like Pigpen is not really in the play, but I thought Pigpen. Huh. Peppermint Patty, not really in the original play, brought her in. So I was mainly there to sing and be part of the chorus, but I had a couple lines. And, you know, the weirdest thing, after 2 weeks of rehearsal, I could lay in bed at night, and I often had trouble sleeping as a kid. I could lay in bed at night, and in order to fall asleep, I could run the whole play, beginning to end, every word of every song, every line of everyone's dialogue. I had two lines in the piece, but somehow it got stuck in my head that I could do the whole play. So obviously, it was something that really interested me, and was deeply inside of me from the very start.
And you still have that skill set?
No. I continued doing plays in high school. I went to 1 year of college and did some theater there. And then, having never been to Texas, moved to Austin when I was 19, because my brother was building houses there and asked if I wanted to come with. A buddy of mine came with. He still lives there with his wife and kid. And we had a theater company and made bands and visual art. And it was kind of, that was my college, really, was Austin, Texas in the 80s.
Yeah. So was theater your passion at the time? Did you even think about film and television and all that?
No. I mean, I thought it'd really be cool to be on TV someday. I mean, my kind of, there was a strange feeling in my head that, wow, if I could be on TV just once and my mom and dad could watch that and my family and see that one time, that would be really great. Otherwise, theater's just fine.
Hmm. Yeah. So did you ever make the trip to New York to do that?
No, I never, that's been not a, a regret per se. I've been in New York a lot in the interim, but right. starting out it was New York or LA, and you know, they were shooting a lot of, is that bugging us? I'm sorry. Just so you know, there's an ice machine or something is turned on back there.
Okay. I don't know if I should turn it off.
It's going to
be open tonight.
It's not that bad. We'll survive.
Okay. All righty. Let's see.
Going to New York. You came to L.A.
Yeah. I was in Austin. I was in a theater company that was really good and really great bunch of people. And our plays became popular. Mm-hmm. And I guess through several years of doing that, I got sort of known as other actors did as being someone to watch on stage per se. Mm-hmm. I guess, and there were, you know, smaller town Austin agents that mm-hmm. Looking for clients to send up for small roles in films that shot in Texas, and mm-hmm. they signed me, and I got a fair amount of those parts, and mm-hmm. would work with a movie star, and they would say, you maybe could do this, you know, you're interesting or you're good or whatever, why are you here? Mm-hmm. And I would say, why would I leave here? I know you're pricing a house. I would say to them, I know you love this town enough to probably even want to live here. Why would I live in New York or LA? And I guess over a period of years, I began, what they said to me is you got to go to one or the other, began to mm-hmm. to resonate. It, you know, I guess that I became a big fish in a small pond there, so mm-hmm. somewhat in that I was getting a lot of work and making a living actually before I even left there. But I knew that in order to play bigger roles, you'd need to live on one of the coasts to be taken seriously, so to speak. There's a bunch of great actors there who will never move to the coast, and people mm-hmm. will never know who they are, but they're terrific, and I'm glad I got to see them and work with them. Yeah. And I guess I was just nuts enough to go one way or the other. I'd work with an actor who convinced me that maybe LA was a better mm-hmm. spot to be. It was more like Texas. You drive your car cheaper than New York, and yes. he'd actually lived in New York a lot. So I took his advice, came here, and that was that. I mean, I'd still really love to do some off-Broadway play in New York sometime, something that changed my life and hopefully others around them.
So how was the pond, coming to the giant pond, mm-hmm. is that daunting? Was it very different, or were you just focusing on your work and trying not to think about it too much?
Yeah, I think a lot of those things all at once. And I tried to... Luckily, I'd worked enough in Texas to where I had my SAG card and I had a demo mm-hmm. reel already, and so I had something to offer when I showed up. Mm-hmm. I'd worked with a really wonderful actress, Brad Davis, who's passed away, and his wife was a casting director, but mm-hmm. when Brad was alive and I worked with him, he said, if you ever move to LA, you know, I'll introduce you to my wife and maybe she can set you up meetings with agents. Mm-hmm. She did. No one really wanted to sign me at that point. One of the lower end agents that she suggested did sign me and you know, had some lean years here, but mostly just liked working and, mm-hmm. and tried to do all I could to avoid real work, because I'd done that for many years and knew what that was, happy to mm-hmm. do it, but it was more fun to be an actor, and it paid a little better. So
was there any discomfort as an actor being, you know, doing a guest spot on a hour long or something like that, where was necessarily good writing, or
was there?
Yeah.
No, if the choice was to, have five lines on a really awful sitcom mm-hmm. or wait tables some more, which I'd done for 10 years, I would take the awful sitcom. Mm-hmm. Different now for me, yeah. but. I admire people who early on have priorities and will turn down work when they come here. I just wasn't that person. I just, mm-hmm. you know, I needed money and needed to survive. And so I kind of took everything that I could for several years and then began to be able to not have to do things I didn't want to do. Mm-hmm. And that's where I'm at now. I don't get to do everything I want to do, but I don't have to do things I don't want to do.
So how long ago was it that you began to feel like that was, you were there? You were
maybe 10 years ago, something like that. Yeah.
And you get cast in all kinds of things. I mean, this movie is, Winter's Bone, you are hard man, mm-hmm. and it's a, you're a scary guy, and then you go something like Eastbound and Down, and you're like, whole different guy. Mm-hmm. People can't even make the connection, really, that you're in both things.
That's good.
Yeah,
yeah,
that's kind of remarkable.
Well, it helps people believe me playing roles. I mean, I guess I've said this a lot lately in interviews, but if I'm watching a movie star play a longshoreman, mm-hmm. I'll often think, wow, that movie star is doing a pretty good job pretending to be a longshoreman. That's really awesome. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, when I walk on screen, hopefully the audience says, oh, there's a longshoreman.
Mm-hmm.
That's something that definitely is a strength as an actor, I think, to be not so known and personal details and all that kind of thing.
Is it interesting when it gets mixed up, when you're kind of, you know, when somebody like Clooney is clearly a movie star but is actually trying to act, and everybody else, there are certain actors who are, you know, where there's a whole range of kinds of actors in the same piece?
Yeah, I don't really feel it like that. And yeah. George is a wonderful actor. I never feel while I'm doing it, wow, I have the advantage because people don't really know who I am.
Right.
And this movie star person, they're going to, you know, not believe as a lawnmower repairman or something. I don't think of it. It's more like watching something afterwards. But at the time, I mean, anybody that I'm on camera with belongs there for some reason, and I try not to really, I guess I don't by nature really generally feel above or below
right.
the other person.
Well, it's not even
great.
That, I'm just saying the ensemble feel, you know, obviously they have to, when you have a movie star in the room, you have to, and it could be anybody, it could be, you know, a lead in something else that's not necessarily as famous as George, but... Mm-hmm. You know, they have to get their close-ups, they have to get their hero shots, and they have to, you know.
I guess so. I try not to be in movies where those are, where that's part of the formula so much.
Right.
But it happens sometimes, I guess. But if I'm working on Winter's Bone in the Ozarks, and someone's cast to play a speaking role who's never acted in their life but's from there, I mm-hmm. mean, at that point, again, I don't feel like, well, I'm the actor, and I will, you know, take this poor non-actor under my tutelage and teach them the ropes. I'm thinking this person's from here. They got the accent. They've got the land. They've got the area inside of them. Or mm-hmm. I mean, I'm just trying to keep up with that person. So yeah, when the camera rolls, there's never any question of who's who or what's what as much mm-hmm. as just trying to tell the story in the best way, trying to be present with the other actor, things like that. But it's more of an after the movie is made or mm-hmm. going to see a movie thing where it's hard to buy some people in certain roles and it's hard. It's hard being an actor. I don't hit it out of the park every time or even get on base every time. You know, you just do mm-hmm. your best and hopefully you get enough home runs lined up to where you're able to have some freedom to choose what you want to do.
What is funny how we've become culturally kind of attuned to the idea that somehow they do have to hit it out of the park every time. It's like it's not okay. I mean, an actor should stretch and do things that aren't necessarily comfortable, and sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't, and a show should work or not work, a movie should, you know, but people aren't really accepting of that as a notion.
It's true. On one level, that's very true. On another level, it feels like you can make, and I don't know if it's still this way, but when I got to town, someone told me, you know, you can make one good movie as an actor and then make six or seven horrible ones in a row,
yeah.
and people will keep hiring you, which seems like a pretty great job. Really.
Yeah, that's true.
When you fail up, that's an unusual industry.
Well, see, I always said that it was the number three. It was always the, you get, as a movie star at least, or as a director,
yeah.
you get one, you know, you have your hit, and then you have three movies to not fail again.
Ah, that's probably true.
And then if you hit the third one, you're screwed. You're done.
Yeah, you got to start over.
You have to go away. Yes.
Reinvent.
Reinvention.
Yes,
you know, go tear up a hotel room or something.
Something.
Do a whole different thing. So I know that Deborah, in this case, did a lot of research. Mm-hmm. A lot of her work is about research.
Mm-hmm.
Did you get dragged into that? Did you have a particular role model or a person you were working with? Or
well, yeah. When I'm playing a role that I don't necessarily know how to do, which I guess is most of them, I love any excuse to learn and research. So
well,
I wasn't.
Before you go there, is that true? I mean, do you really, when you look at a piece of paper, something on a script, you look mm-hmm. at a script, do you really go, I don't know how to do this, I'm going to go try it?
Well, you know, I'm trying to think of who said it. It might have been David Mamet who said that the very best thing that you can do as an actor, and I believe it's true, whoever said it, I believe it was him, basically, is to when you begin a role, say, I don't know how to do this, so that you can begin from a point of innocence, if you will, uh-huh. from a square one, and then begin to answer all the questions and solve all the problems that you need to solve in order to figure out how to do the part.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I never quite know what to do, even if it's someone pretty close to me, unless it's someone really close to me, someone's written right. something right into me and I'm basically sort of playing a version of myself, that's different, but that's rare. So
because I often hear either, you know, I know I can hit it out of the park, or it scared me so much I knew how to do it.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's different every time, but I never have a real handle because, for one thing, I haven't met the other actors, and for me to have made all my decisions and show up and be like a little robot isn't mm-hmm. going to do anybody any good, including right. myself or the story or the other people. So, you know, while you're preparing, you try to have some, you try to keep an openness about you and a you know, to be able to, acting is reacting, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You can make things up. One of the processes I use, I guess, is to, as an untrained actor, is to over-prepare as much as I can and then forget it all when the camera rolls and try to just mm-hmm. be there with the person and tell the story. But for this one, I was so excited about the script and for anyone, actually. I like to research. I like to have to learn
mm-hmm.
things. It's going to school. So for this one, it was learning about methamphetamines is something that I really didn't have that much interest in knowing deeply mm-hmm. about, but it's not that certain. I mean, a lot of drug addicts aren't that interesting of people. I mean, they're usually mm-hmm. pretty boring people, ultimately. But this story wasn't really necessarily about meth. It was more the 800-pound gorilla in the room. It's not like it was talked about or constantly, shown or anything like that, but certainly meth would be a big part of Teardrop's existence, so I had to learn all that. There was a novel that I could read, there mm-hmm. was an accent that I had to learn, there was a history of that area that I wanted to find out about why it is like it is today.
Mm-hmm.
There was a book called Almost Midnight, which spoke of a lot of these things. It was a true crime book of a murder in very, very near the area where our story took place.
Mm-hmm.
Also around meth, a very different story. But that book told about bars that you shouldn't go into if you're a tourist and things, mm-hmm. and I beelined to those places, not in any kind of cocky or show-offy way, as much as just to see if I could pass and see what mm-hmm. I can learn in those places just by being a fly on the wall.
Hmm.
That was invaluable. And then you try to figure out who this fictional person you're playing. I always ask, you know, a lot of questions and make up a back history, all this kind of stuff that's kind of embarrassing and silly to talk about, but ultimately brings me to a place where when the camera rolls on the first day, I can feel like I'm a whole person and then I can forget all that and like I say, just be there and do what needs to be done, be open to the director, the other actors.
So where do you put all that after you're done?
Well, you know, those I think those dark characters, those dark-hearted characters too, again, I don't have formal training as an actor, but I like to read the script over and over and over. Even doing that is a form of pretending, I guess, just imagining mm-hmm. yourself in that circumstance that the character is in. It's a form of pretending, I guess. So even just pretending something in your head every day, well, I guess what I'm getting to is that the dark characters take a piece of you, you know, mm-hmm. a little bit. So at the end of the day, I don't know where that goes. I guess it just goes away a bit. You know, mm-hmm. there'll always be kind of a piece left inside of me of that person, mm-hmm. and hopefully you let go of the parts that are painful and hard to pretend and deal with, hard to feel.
So I guess when you go to, you know, you go to elementary school and you say, or high school and they say, am I going to use trigonometry ever again?
Uh-huh.
You know, you do that every time you do a role. That's like
maybe so. But the funny thing is if I had another role that was similar, I would want to, you know, learn a different kind of trigonometry or read a different trigonometry book to approach the mm-hmm. role, so to speak.
So now that you're in a position where you can be more selective,
mm-hmm.
what does draw you in? Is it the idea of working with a particular director? Is it something you see in the script? Is it the character? Is it the overall circumstances?
I think it's all those things. I think my mantra for many years has always been I would like to play great roles with great people in amazing stories.
Mm-hmm.
So the size of the role, the way the role relates to the story is key. that can be trumped in rare circumstances by a really just amazing piece as a whole and an amazing director and amazing actors around you. Money can figure in at times, depending on how much a person's working at a given moment. But to be honest, it's a pretty small part. You know, you could pull my agents and manager aside, and they would say to you that for every role we bring them that's an offer or a great audition that's for a studio movie, that I don't think I probably almost hold a stronger magnifying glass to those films in a strange way. And I often end up doing stuff that's pretty cheap or free. You know, that's about to happen again. So,
well, you don't have to. It doesn't sound like you have to make a ton of money to be happy.
No, my mother's taken care of, and you know, the rest of my family seems to be doing good, and so I live, you know, pretty low to the ground, I guess. I live in a nice house and have a car and all that kind of thing. But yeah, I don't need that much money to live, and so. I guess I don't have to work to pay off a mortgage or a child support or alimony or things like that, so I can be particular.
So what makes a great director for you?
Someone who doesn't guess, someone who's got a point of view, knows what they want to do, is able to communicate it to those around them. There's so many ways to tell a story, and to me, kind of all of art, whether it's music or sculpture on some level, or you know, anything is really about a story, whether it's a linear story or not. There's a feeling or a story or I'm always trying to figure out where is the story in the piece I'm working on. So it's just a director who, I guess it's such personal taste, but someone like Deborah Granik tells a story so much in the way that I would want to tell a story if I were directing something. She's just really top of the line. I don't know why, even. I just know that I felt like I was got by her. I got her, and I felt like I felt got by her from the start. I don't know why, but her approach just feels perfect to me as an actor. I don't know why. Again, it's just something that from the start I knew that this is someone that I understand. I also like working with women directors. I'm not sure why, but I've always seemed to have pretty good luck for the most part, communication-wise, things like that. I was raised mainly by my mother, so maybe that's why. I'm not sure. But
so you recently made something with Vera Farmiga directing. So she's both a woman and an actor.
Yeah.
Is it different working for an actor as director, or...?
You know, you'd think so, but it kind of isn't so much. I think that there's maybe a weight on someone who's directing and acting in something that isn't in it on a director who's not actually appearing in things. But that didn't really manifest in ways that were negative or didn't really affect my dealings with her, I didn't feel. I was often in scenes with her where she's directing the scene. But I don't know, for whatever reason, it's been different in every case when someone's done that, but with her it didn't really feel like it was detrimental to what was going on.
Do you have a particular way you like to be handled on set?
I don't like to be yelled at across the set.
Over a bullhorn?
Yeah, I don't want to be shouted instruction, because it's hard enough kind of being an actor, particularly if you're struggling in a scene and having problems, and you're shouted a direction across the set, the whole crew then, when they call action, turns to see if you've done it. You know, suddenly you've got another audience watching to see. I'd prefer to be treated like an adult, I guess.
Do you expect much from a director who does that, though? I mean, going in, a director who would do that doesn't seem like somebody who would...
No, I try not to work with that person.
Yeah.
But then again, I've worked with great directors who, by shorthand, and because there's just no time to get up, will shout a direction. I just don't want it constantly.
Right.
You know, I understand when it needs to happen, because there's 3 minutes of light left, the sun's going down, and they just want you to go faster with that speech. Okay, great, I can do that.
Yeah.
But, or slow it down, whatever. Don't pick your nose. I don't get that one a lot, really. That's good. I was never really a child actor. So, but
you don't like, we're not seeing your soul.
Yeah, exactly.
Show us your soul.
Make it more fuchsia. Or something. No, I guess I don't need to think the director's a nice person, anything like that. I just need to know that they have an idea of what they want to do, can communicate it to the people around them, and aren't you know, misanthropic, mean, horrible people. Yeah. That helps too.
And how do you connect to the final product? I mean, it sounds like you do all this work and you put it all out there on the set. Does the movie that comes out of that terribly important to you? Is it something you're focused on, or?
Well, if it feels like a great story that I'd want to see, then it is terribly important to me. There's things I've done within the last year that I'll never see. Mm-hmm. And I'm not interested in seeing. I'm not one of those actors who doesn't ever watch the work that I do by any means. Mm-hmm. I'm really interested in what I've done. I'm really interested in what the people around me have done. I'm really interested in what the wardrobe people have accomplished and how it all went together and what the editor did and what kind of music they put in and all those kind of things interest me a great deal. I like movies, so just because I'm in it doesn't mean it's going to be terrible or something. It's something that I don't want to see.
So do you... When it's a movie that you are interested in, are you anxious to see it with an audience? Do you like to see it by yourself in a room?
I don't get that choice, man. I don't get generally you know, here's a copy, you can watch it. Yeah, oftentimes...
Take it on the private plane. And
yeah, that doesn't happen for me. But oftentimes the first time I see a movie is with an audience at Sundance or at another film festival or at a preview, you know, premiere, right. I guess they call them, things like that. Yeah.
So when's the first time you saw Winter's Bone?
Sundance.
So you saw it in Eccles?
Yes, I did.
So what was it like to have 1,500 or 1,700 people, or whatever, was in there experiencing this movie,
It was great, but I mean, you can't really tell what people around you are thinking, and early on that feels important, and then it just kind of drifts away, and I just kind of get lost in it. I've been doing this for quite a while, and I've been lucky enough to work on a lot of movies, but this may be my favorite piece I've ever done. And I don't think I've ever said that about any other thing really in an interview, but it, for whatever reason, maybe it's just because my kind, it's a film that I would want to go see. So I was watching it at Sundance. I was, you know, when you come on screen, you're jarred a little bit, and then there's all these questions of like what got cut and what didn't get cut, things like that. But it was a revelation to see the first time, and I had some idea of what was coming, I guess, but hadn't seen a frame of it. But you know, I'd read the script obviously and knew the novel and had an idea of how it would roll out, but it was a pretty amazing experience.
And when the wave of audience love comes.
Well, that's pretty cool, man. I'd be lying if I didn't say that I didn't care what people thought, because I do. I want to make things that matter to people. And when someone tells you that you've done something that matters to them, that's pretty cool.
And do you put away the work, the film, or the history of that afterwards, or do you, and moving on to the next thing? Or
I'd like to, but guys like you keep showing up, I can't keep...
Well, if you're fortunate, we'll be showing up for another 3 or 4 months.
I hope so, man.
Keep the ball rolling.
No, it's terrific. It's been a challenge to try to kind of really remember what all that was, because there's a spate of interviews around it,
right.
And then there's a spate of interviews when it comes out, and now... Because of the DVD release and the awards talk that's kindly been afforded this film, you're talking about it again. In the meantime, I've done, I don't know, 5 or 6 or 7 other characters in between I'm trying to keep separate.
Are you a person that puts things away? I mean, when you finish a film, is that film, you've had your experience, it's gotten out in whatever form, you like it, you don't like it, whatever it is. And then you move on, or do you carry a piece of it with you? And
well, if it's something that's crappy, that piece is gone away, hopefully, and I don't have to deal with it much unless I see it on television or someone brings it up or something like that. But trying to do stuff I'm proud of, and stuff that won't be a future skeleton in the closet. But this one, no, I don't think I'll ever put this one away because I prefer to carry a piece of this with me.
Good long time. Thank you so much.
Ah, thanks, Dave.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, sir.